Broadcasting live. It's America's longest running talk show on computers. It's Computer America, bringing you the biggest names in technology with guest interviews, new products, and your emails. Listen live at computeramerica.com on any device around the world. Email the show at live@computeramerica.com or find us on social media. Be sure to check out our website for contests, giveaways, show notes, live video stream, podcasts, and more. You're listening to Computer America.
Hello and welcome to the Computer America Show. We are the nation's longest running, nationally syndicated radio talk show on computers and technology. And everyone, hey, welcome into the program. So joining us today is the one, the only, Mr. Ralph Bond. He is our science and tech trends correspondent. And hey, you know, of course, he is going to be here to talk about all of the latest stories that, you know, a lot of them we almost undoubtedly did not get to, because for the past week we have been neck deep in CES 2021. And, you know, that the fallout from all of that, I got to say that, you know, I'll talk about it with Ralph, because Ralph has been to past events like CES and the first all digital one that they did, for obvious reasons. That was different. So we'll talk a little bit about that and, you know, kind of how I personally see CES going forward, and of course, Ralph's reaction as well. But before we get to that, everyone, computeramerica.com. That's where you'll find everything, including past shows, future shows, all the shows. And there you'll also find links to any of the articles. Ralph does a really good job of, you know, collecting all the articles, sourcing all of them. And after today's show, we'll have them up ready for you to find. And, you know, it's going to be a lot of fun. So check it out, computeramerica.com. Why are there social media links, podcasts, articles, reviews, so on and so forth. So everyone, I hope that you're doing well. I hope that everything is as well can be. And I hope that you're, you know, relaxed on this Friday and we can relax a little bit more with Ralph. So let's go ahead, bring him on and get talking. So everyone, as I said before, Ralph Bond, he first joined us years ago as the voice for our Intel segment, and of course, continued on with us as a regular correspondent, and as time went on, well, he has evolved like a beautiful butterfly into our science and tech trends correspondent. And Ralph, how you doing? There you go. Well, and really, our segments have really focused on, you know, kind of cutting edge tech stuff that, you know, consumers may not see on store shelves today, but will definitely impact their lives in the future. New CEO, yeah. Yeah. I was actually pretty curious if you had worked with or known Pat Gelsinger, because he we did a little bit of his background thanks to Wikipedia, but he actually was like the head designer of the Intel 80486 processor, or the i486 processor back in 1989. So like, this guy isn't just I guess the gentleman stepping down from the position was kind of from the financial side of things, and this gentleman is more from the engineering side of things. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Sounds like sounds like just the person that the Intel needs lately. They've been struggling, especially on, it's been very famously reported on that they are having troubles with their research and development in the engineering side. So yeah, I really do hope the best for it. Yeah, exactly, for Intel. Mm-hmm. I'm super excited for that as well. And again, we spoke on this yesterday, and it seems like no one has a bad word to say about him. And I really do hope that Intel, can really come back swing, because I was just talking with Craig about this yesterday, that Intel is like in a sea of chips: TSMC, AMD, Samsung, Sony. In the sea of chip manufacturing, everything happens in Taiwan, South Korea, Singapore, China. And really, when you talk about American, made in America, that kind of thing, it's Intel. Like, that's about it for American-made silicon. So I definitely don't want to see Intel, kind of go down that road. But, okay, so there's that. And then the other little part before we get into our topics for the day, if you're watching the video portion, you can see Ralph, myself, and the topics. But before we get to that, and by the way, Ralph, I was just marveling, really, that obviously you're in space. That's great. I hope the weather's great up there. But I was just marveling that the fact that, we're using Zoom, and Zoom has like a false green screen kind of deal. And I was just thinking that, like, the quality of yours, obviously you could tell that, it's digital and, there's some manipulation going on there. But like, I wouldn't put it beyond, like, let's say the 90s when it came to like weather guys and, that whole thing. Technology has advanced to the point where, you don't have to invest in all these crazy setups. You just get to do it. Right, in the space between. Well, I'm sure that if you put your hand up and you kind of spread your fingers a little bit towards the camera, you can see. Yeah, so, yes. It really is. And so that's okay, wow. Oh my God, Ralph, I'm so sorry. I had you potted up this whole time. I had no idea. So Ralph says some very nice things about Pat, and now he's in space, and man, I really wish I didn't have you potted up there. Someone in the audience just told me, and I really apologize for that. But okay, so we're ignoring that. We're moving on, going forward.
No
Ralph,
worries.
I did want to bring up one thing to you. And that was CES 2021. I don't know if you had a chance to attend, because I think a lot of people were able to attend that weren't able to before, because it was all digital. And I don't know if you had any interest in, signing up and seeing how things went this year.
Yeah. It's, to me, having gone to many CES shows in my career, in some respects, nothing replaces that amazing experience of being with thousands of people. There's that energy, and there's also the serendipity of going down aisles and suddenly discovering something that you might not otherwise ever really know about. But on the other side of the coin, I love the democracy of opening this up to the World Wide Web and allowing people to virtually attend. I think that's a plus, but I'm worried that the only players that can afford to stage that for themselves, perhaps, and get up on the docket for that kind of exposure might be only the big companies. And so some of the smaller boutique companies that often are very, very interesting might get lost in the fray. So I don't know what your opinion is, but those are some of the thoughts I've had about this whole digital CES.
Yeah, and I was looking through some of the numbers. They had about just under 2,000 companies sign up, and I think that a lot of companies, kind of took your, took the same point of view that you had, because CES 2020, which was a pretty big year, things were going well, and that had just under 5,000 companies sign up. So 5,000 down to 2,000. And if I'm not mistaken, the visitors for, you know, the online visitors, I think they were anticipating about 150,000 online visitors as opposed to 2020 year, which was 170,000 attendees. But of course, 170,000 people physically there is very different than 150,000 people who just went to the site, you know, during the show. Like, that's a huge drop in viewership as well. I gotta say that, you know, I did all 3 days. I saw the keynotes. Some companies, they had it great. Some companies were able to get out there. They had product videos. Samsung, I don't know if you saw theirs, Ralph. Samsung's was well choreographed, well made. It was good to go. LG, I think it was LG instead, had a background that looked much like yours, except it was the LG logo. I'm sorry, not LG. TCL. TCL had a background that looked just like yours. And it was one gentleman standing up there saying, this year was great. We have great products and you should check them out. And that was the end of their keynote.
Okay.
And, you know, there was such a disparity about companies that were embracing the digital versus just like, we're here for this year. I hope next year it's going to be back to normal.
Yeah.
Well, so we'll see. And there you go. So, how you doing, Rob? So with all that being said, this year, you know, we did our best. We contacted like 150 different companies, to come on the show. You know, I'm looking forward to next year being in person. I don't think it's, you know, if this was any kind of test to be like, you know, is CES going to go all digital forever? No, people are still going to enjoy going there, shaking hands, and hopefully not have to social distance next year.
Yeah.
So, there you go. There's CES 2021. Ralph, I think that with that being said, why don't we go ahead and get to our topics of the day? Because you're here, you know, you're here with a plan, you're here with show notes, and we can go ahead and get started with this.
Okay, sounds great. And by the way, everybody, as longtime listeners know, Ben will post the show notes. You can get all this stuff. We inevitably never make it through all the stories. I have 15 story candidates today. We're not going to get through them. That's okay. You can come and get the show notes, the links, pictures, all this good stuff are there for you. So with that said, let's jump into the first story. This is really kind of neat. I you know me, I love anything that's kind of medical, science, technology related, and especially things that help people with disabilities and that sort of thing. So here's the headline. Comes from CNN, by the way. Artificial skin developed by RMIT Australia can feel pain. Let that sink in for a second. Wow. Isn't that something?
There we go. That's how we stymie the robot uprising, is that we make them feel as bad as we do.
Oh, I like that. So researchers at the Royal Melbourne Institute of Technology University in Australia have created an artificial skin that mimics our skin's ability to constantly monitor for pain and the mechanism to react to pain stimuli. Oh, wow. Made of silicone rubber, it has the texture of real skin. And just like real skin, the artificial version is designed to react when pressure, heat, or cold surpass a pain threshold. Think of the science behind all this. That's just amazing. The outer layers of the artificial pain feeling skin have embedded electronic circuits studded with sensors, which respond to stimuli. When one of the sensors in the artificial skin detects a pain stimulus, it sends an electrical signal to the brain, much the same as pain receptors in our own natural skin signal our brain. The result is artificial skin that can differentiate between a gentle pinprick or a painful stab. This groundbreaking advancement could lead to amazing innovations in smart prosthetics and robotics. So I have, and this is also indicative of something I want to share. What I do is look for these cool stories, grab them, I distill them down to super approachable, simplified, you know, cliff notes condensations at the extreme. So there's a lot more to this story than I'm giving you right now. So check it out, look at the links and learn more about this. Fascinating stuff.
Right. Yeah. Lots of quotes from the scientists there and, you know, kind of what they're thinking is with this and the potential, Ralph. And of course, you know, you mentioned that, there at the end, this could lead to amazing innovations in smart prostheses and robotics. What did that mean to you? Just off top of your head.
Oh, I just, you know, you think about somebody, let's just take our veterans mm-hmm. of foreign wars and so forth, who maybe have, through an IED, have lost a leg or an arm, or God forbid, both or something. Can you imagine someday being able to outfit them not only with something that allows them some functionality, but gives them the added dimension of feeling? I mean, and then anybody else who has these kinds of challenges, how wonderful. I'm just speechless in a way with hope for this, for the future, for people in that category.
Definitely. And, you know, really to me, it seems like the reason that you would want to add pain of all sensations, you know, of course you have like touch and, you know, kind of texture, yeah, and that kind of thing. Yeah. Why pain? And I got to say that pain is very useful, obviously, because it lets you know that, hey, fire hot, don't touch fire. It protects you. You know, pain is a very good sensor, exactly, for protecting yourself. And I'm sure that people who spend, you know, a lot of money on these prostheses, and, you know, because many of them can be very expensive, yes, but also just the fact that, you know, maybe you use your prosthesis to grab something, touch something, and then you touch it with something that is not your prosthesis, and then you feel the pain. That's also not good. So I guess from like a, you know, kind of protect your limbs, even if they're your fake limbs, from a standpoint, that's very important. And, yeah, you know, just the fact that, you know, if you start crushing your little finger on your prosthetic hand, you know, oh, hey, I need to pay attention to something over here. It's just going to be, I guess, more realistic to the people wearing it. Like the one thing I have to say about that, Ralph, is that, like, I think people associate pain with only a bad thing, and pain,
right,
alerts you, and that's important.
Exactly right. And touch, pain, feeling, temperature recognition, that sort of thing. Think of something as simple as baking and cooking. Mm-hmm. All of a sudden, somebody with a prosthetic arm and hand could have an experience with those kinds of activities that they would not have otherwise with a typical prosthetic. So, wow.
And I guess, you know, to us, we kind of take it for granted that, you know, the oven is hot and, you know, the cookies are hot and that kind of thing. But maybe someone who does not have these prostheses, you know, who requires these, would like to feel that as well, you know. So,
absolutely,
little things like that. And yeah, Ralph, I got to say that is, you know, really, along with renewable energy, I got to say that medical technology seems to be something,
yes,
that you definitely pay attention to, which we appreciate.
And a good segue to the next story, by the way.
Absolutely. And so, story number two, please go for it.
Here we go. Comes from Popular Mechanics. Artificial intelligence solves momentous disease fighting problem decades ahead of schedule. Well, I couldn't resist that headline, right? I mean, that's just freaking awesome. And there's another link in my show notes to another source as well, because I kind of tried to go in deep on this one. But here we go. Damaged and or incorrectly folded proteins play a role in several neurological diseases, including Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, Huntington's, and Lou Gehrig's disease, which was very interesting to me because I had really, frankly, no idea about this business of folded proteins. For 50 years, scientists have been struggling to figure out how proteins fold up. Only a fraction of the millions of known proteins have actually been unfolded to fully understand what they do and how they work. That's because unfolding proteins usually takes years of tedious work in a lab using equipment costing millions of dollars. So, recently, an artificial intelligence program called AlphaFold, created by Google's, hooray for them, DeepMind Research Project, demonstrated it could map misfolded proteins in a matter of days and do it with more detail than ever before, allowing scientists to better explore possible treatments. So, okay, great, good stuff, but a little reality check here. The AlphaFold project shows a lot of promise, but it's not 100% yet when compared to human scientists doing the same work. The AlphaFold program has achieved so far 2/3 of their accuracy, but still, this is a huge and promising advance for medical science. You know, it's just going to get better and better and better.
Do you remember some of the, and of course, if you're watching the video portion, this is the video included one of your articles, Ralph, talking about, you know, what these folded proteins even mean for the entirety of this. But I got to say that, Ralph, do you remember the other DeepMind projects that Google had? There was, of course, AlphaGo was pretty famous.
Right.
Yep.
Some of the vision stuff they've been working on and so forth. And Google, you know, Google is an incredible research beast in its own right. What was it, 2019, they had their quantum supremacy they achieved. And just,
that's been disputed, though.
Is that right?
this is just personal. I'm not giving Google that one. They made a purposely convoluted question, and then they answered it with a supercomputer that it was tailored for, and it could have been simplified. Anyways, that being said,
fair enough.
this is a result of their AlphaGo, and I think they have like an Alpha Chess that they did as well, where Deep Blue was the chess playing artificial intelligence from IBM, if I'm not mistaken, the one that also played Jeopardy. It was a very multifaceted AI. So AlphaGo beat those Go players and did so very, very quickly. And I think that AlphaFold is going to be the same way, where this year, you know, we're talking about it now, two-thirds accuracy, not that great. It's a computer. As long as you have electricity, as long as Google can keep the lights on, it's going to keep working and improving and getting better and better. Ralph, I'm wondering if scientists have already decided to, you know, obviously, if it's not completely accurate like humans, they're not going to do this. But if they're able to, kind of use this and use the output from it, they can at least go, all right, here are some of the possible answers to these protein folding. Let's have these scientists, you know, just kind of look through the output of AlphaFold and the rest keep doing what they're already doing. No, you're right.
It could be a symbiotic thing where the AI program, as it stands today, with about a two-thirds accuracy rate currently, it could take it up to X point, and then the humans could take over and say, let's cherry pick this result and see if we can take it to the finish line. So, yeah.
I'm trying to think, and it may have been Watson as well that was doing the cancer screening with all the different x-rays of cancer that they were doing glaucoma as well. Like they needed like a million or 5 million images to train the AI, but then it was as good as a doctor, but it never replaced a single doctor. It helped doctors quickly screen and
that's
do that kind
right
of thing. Yeah, so I definitely see
symbiotic
AlphaFold. Yeah, definitely. Ralph, actually, one last thing on this. Before AlphaFold, do you know what they did for protein folding? Like, do you know what the project before this was?
No, I don't, to be honest with you.
So the fun thing on this was they actually tried to gamify it, and they tried to release it out there. I don't know if you remember the SETI product.
This sounds familiar.
They had two different ways they could do it. You could either donate your computer's processing power while it was not in use, and they would actually put it towards protein folding manipulation. So your computer would contribute to protein folding. That was before this. I think that you can still do it as well. And then the other one was to actually sit down, Ralph, and scientists would upload folded proteins that look much like the top of the page here. And they allowed, you know, they kind of thrust it towards like people who play a lot of video games and things like that. And they said, all right, public, you know, we are only 100,000 scientists in the entire international protein folding community. You are tens, hundreds of millions of people fold these proteins. And, you know, you just had exponentially more people, more brains, more eyes, because, you know, it's science, but it's not really science. Like, it's literally, you know, twisting it this way, folding it over this way, putting it's almost like a giant
bump car.
It's almost like a giant Ralph. I don't know, when you take out the Christmas lights, and you know, I was thinking of Christmas Vacation with that giant, the giant tangle of Christmas lights.
Yes, God.
It's the exact same thing with protein folding. So they had, you know, infinitely more people go ahead and give it their best attempt. So that was before AlphaFold as well.
Well, that's great.
Yeah, that was my little thing. So obviously scientists are working with AI. They're working with the public. They're trying everything they can to tackle unfolding these proteins. Because like you said, Ralph, this is kind of the key to solving Alzheimer's, dementia, cancer, you know, so many different things in our lives.
Yeah.
This can definitely help. So.
Yep.
Story number two, great one. We're almost halfway done with the show. Two stories in. We're making great time. Ralph, story number three. Go for it.
Well, yeah. And again, to your point, that's why I encourage people to come and get the show notes so that they can pick up where we're not going to be able to go. And that's okay. That's cool. Mm-hmm. So story number three, this is kind of fun, comes from Engadget. The headline is Raven X. I never could determine whether it was Raven X or the Roman numeral for 10, right? But regardless, Raven X, I'll call it that for now, is a 55,000-pound drone for launching satellites. Huh. Couldn't resist that. You can see a picture of it. You have the show notes. It's a very cool looking thing. So recently, a company based out of Alabama called Avium unveiled the Raven X, that's R-A-V-N in this case, a drone airplane designed to carry and launch satellites into low orbit. It weighs approximately 55,000 pounds when it's carrying a full payload, making it one of the heaviest unmanned aircraft in existence today. It stands 18 feet tall and has a wingspan of 60 feet. Now, the promise of the drone is that it can put a payload in low Earth orbit in approximately 3 hours, which the developers claim will shorten lead times on satellite launches from years to months. Other than its ominous military-looking exterior, the Raven X drone isn't so different from traditional airplanes. It only needs about a one-mile runway to get into the air, allowing it to take off from almost any commercial airport. And it also uses the same fuel as a traditional jet. So I just love this creative idea. Here's another way to get satellites, more satellites, up into orbit.
Yeah, the idea of more satellites has been coming up a lot as we are just filling and filling the sky with them.
Oh my gosh.
But isn't that true? But I got to say that I never considered that, you know, we've been hearing a lot about SpaceX, and when they send up satellites, they're taking up, you know, 50 of them at a time. And I never considered, oh, well, not really a plane. You know, in most ways, a plane. The only thing it's missing is the pilot. So, you know, at, again, 55,000 pounds. Ralph, this thing is a plane just without a pilot, right? Like this, they call it a drone because there is no person. Well, but
right.
It's very, very incredible. And of course, the video that you saw there was it kind of, you know, the little promo video there. I got to say that it's military looking. Ralph, was this this was done by a private company, right?
Yeah, a company, an outfit in Alabama called Avium. Or Avum, A-E-V-U-M. Yeah. Right, Avum.
It's very cool that more and more private companies are getting into the space as well. So I hope to never see this thing above my head. And I guess that's kind of the point. It's big. It's pretty scary looking too. But there you go. So, yep. This. And Ralph, did you see who the first customer was? Obviously.
Oh, I'm sure it must be the military. There you go. Yeah.
The Space Force.
Of course, the Space Force. And aren't Space Force men and women called Guardians?
I think they are, but that also might have been a trademark by Marvel, and I don't think they gave
I was going to say, Guardians of the Galaxy, they probably violated trademark.
I think they did, and of course, you can get so close with that, but yeah, and of course, Space Force is just, I think that's under the category of the Air Force, so,
yes.
But yeah, still.
Well, it should be, but it's its own branch now, but in my opinion, it should have stayed in the Air Force, yes. That was the whole kind of laugh. Well, not, I don't mean to be disparaging, but many people found it kind of funny to split. Right. However, they took the Army Air Corps and split it off after the Second World War to be the Air Force. So, okay, Space Force, fine.
Right. Yeah, although I got to say that the U.S. Space Force is organized as a military service branch within the Department of the Air Force. So,
it's still nested in. I see. Okay.
If,
well, thank you.
If you can believe Wikipedia. And by the way, just real quick, a happy birthday to Wikipedia. Wikipedia is now 20 years old today.
Wow.
So,
wow.
Fun little fact. Wikipedia definitely being a thing. I wouldn't even get into the space. In all honesty, the Space Force makes perfect sense. That was actually one of the things that I really did agree with. There's so much going on with space. You need one agency to just focus on space instead of everyone having a patchwork response to it. So regardless, very cool drone. And yeah, again, more private companies being able to do this. I definitely like that. Story number four. Let's go ahead and do it.
Yes. And we were talking about quantum computers and your hesitation and questioning about the Google's achievement and so forth. So this fits right in here. This is coming out of China. So, you know, maybe we have to take this with a grain of salt. Maybe not. Let's see. But this comes from sciencenews.org, a story by Emily Conover. The headline was, "A new light-based Chinese quantum computer has achieved quantum supremacy." And so what I'll do is a quick refresh, not for your benefit, Ben, because you could probably add
tremendous value. Oh, please do.
But for the general folks out there like me. So a quick refresh, traditional computers versus quantum computers. Okay, let's start there. Today's computers use bits, a stream of electrical or optical pulses representing the ones and zeros of binary code, of course. And quantum computers, on the other hand, use what are called qubits, which are typically subatomic particles such as electrons or photons. And quantum supremacy refers to doing amazing calculations, impossible, and I would say theoretically impossible, mm-hmm. for a convention, or practically impossible for a conventional computer to do. So that's what they mean by quantum supremacy. So it's two things: a quantum computer using qubits instead of the traditional bits and through all the technology associated with that. And the second thing is being able to do calculations that would be just completely impossible, virtually speaking, for a traditional computer to do. So with that said, here's the big news. Again, it's coming out of China, so, you know, you have to decide if it's very credible or not. But researchers at the University of Science and Technology of China recently developed a prototype photonic quantum computer that uses particles of light or photons to perform a calculation that would be impossible or just so difficult or so long time to do it that it's not worth even trying for a conventional computer. So quantum supremacy, now we talked about this before, has been met once before, so claimed by Google in 2019 with their quantum computer, which uses tiny quantum bits made of superconducting materials which conduct energy without resistance. Again, it's fair for you to call that into question, but that's the way they positioned it in the article. Now, mm-hmm. In contrast, the new Chinese quantum computer consists of a complex array of light beam splitters, dozens of mirrors, and 100 photon detectors that shuttle photons around, of course, at blinding, amazing, incomprehensible speeds. The Chinese quantum computer can perform a calculation, according to this article, can perform a calculation in 200 seconds that would take more than a half billion years for the world's fastest non-quantum or conventional computer available today. That's just mind-blowing. That's what I meant to say by, you can say impossible for a mm-hmm. traditional computer to do. Answer, no, not impossible, but it would take a half billion years if you accept all the premise in this article. Reality check, of course, to date, quantum computers, Google, China, elsewhere, have only been solving esoteric calculations meant to thwart, Ben, as you know, conventional computers, and have yet to be applied to solve real world problems. But someday, if they can get this all, you know, really working well and practical, imagine what that computational capability could do to do with what we were just talking about, scientific research and that sort of thing. Wow. So it's interesting.
Yeah, I gotta say that you know, really the way that this article breaks down how the supercomputer works, it's different than the ones we've had explained to us here on the show through IBM and Google. This is a different, you know, using the photons, splitting it, and letting them kind of interweave and superposition themselves. It was you know, that part was very, very different and new to me. I had no idea about that. But a couple of quotes here from the article, you know, that, like you said, you quoted that the calculations are esoteric ones designed to be difficult for classical computers, you know, which again was kind of the point. that, you know, here's a calculation that you just said, Ralph, was meant to be difficult for classic computers.
Exactly.
And then, of course, even in the article, they mentioned what I mentioned with Google. After Google's quantum supremacy claim, IBM proposed a type of calculation that might allow a supercomputer, so not necessarily like the one that you and I are using, but at least a modern supercomputer could perform the task that Google's computer could, at least theoretically. You know, they did not waste supercomputer resources to prove that that this could be done. But yeah, you know, so Google claimed quantum supremacy. Others have disputed that. And, you know, even as the article itself points out, even if you do achieve it, that doesn't mean they're useful. You know, it just means that
at
hey,
this time.
Yeah, it just means that quantum computers can do the thing that quantum computers were meant to do. And then we can go forward from there. So,
exactly, right.
Still, the first part of this and the images are absolutely crazy. Quantum computers and, you know, kind of the way that they're set up. I still remember one of the first ones, and it was, you know, Ralph, much like the early 50s and 60s, you know, with computers where scientists were inside the computers, you know, kind of plugging jacks together and, you know, wiring them from the inside. Quantum computers are the exact same way. You know, scientists were standing inside the quantum computer, and nowadays, you know, they're about the size of, I guess, like a horse trailer. You know, they're a size like, you know, 10 by 10 by 10. They're like a big old cube. But
I can't resist a little trivia, and I'm sure you know this one. But
go for it.
back in the day when computers were still using vacuum tubes, right? And they would heat up and so forth. They have terrible problems, and the vacuum tubes. I'm old enough to remember going to the grocery store to get tubes to replace in our television set. I mean, that's how old I am. anyway, the team of at that time, women who would go in with tongs to extract moths and so forth that would die and short out the vacuum tube system, debug. That's what I understand the origins of that term comes
from. I had
from.
No idea.
Isn't that fun? Check that out. I think, I don't know whether that's urban myth or true, but I believe it comes from Bell Labs or something. I don't remember where that comes from, but it's debugging, literally going in and getting, you know, moths mostly and other things that were shorting out the and messing up the vacuum tube arrays.
Once again, according to Wikipedia, you are correct saying that the terms bug and debugging are popularly attributed to Admiral Grace Hopper in the 1940s, where at Harvard University, her associates discovered a moth stuck in a relay, thereby impeding operation, and she remarked that they were debugging the system. So
you love it, don't you? Isn't that great?
No, that's definitely a fun piece of trivia, and I will definitely remember that. And I got to say that so supercomputers, they hopefully no moths are there because you know, the instruments are much more sensitive. But what I'm saying is that you know, back in the 40s, 50s, and 60s, they were huge. You know, they were the size of rooms. And look at our computers today. Like there are microchips that are smaller than the tip of your finger. It's really incredible. So that's story number four, and I Ralph, I gotta say that whole story, Chinese based, different type of quantum computer, claiming it, I mean, heck, that's what the peer review community and the scientific community is all about. You know, they always love something like that. So story number five though, this looks right up my alley because man, I'm hungry. So story number five.
There you go. So the headline is fun. It comes from CNET, a story by Brian Cooley. Headline is Beyond the Impossible, a reference to Impossible Burgers. That's a brand you may be aware of a non.
I've had it,
And actually, I find them to be very flavorful and very satisfying. But anyway, Beyond the Impossible, meat grown from cells is better for the planet if you'll eat it. So it's kind of a fun, intriguing story, but actually there's some good science here. Lab-grown meat from animal cells may start arriving at your supermarket, they predict, around 2022 from companies such as Mosameat, Memphis Meats, and others. It will be positioned as a more sustainable, environmentally friendly option for meat eaters. The plan is to grow animal cells, for example, chicken or beef, in bioreactors like those already used to produce pharmaceuticals and ethanol. Boy, this was a whole world I didn't know about. A bioreactor, by the way, is a device or apparatus in which living organisms, and especially bacteria, synthesize useful substances, such as interferon, or break down harmful ones, such as in sewage. So here's how this lab meat growing process works in a nutshell, and we're simplifying things. A few animal cells are chosen for the type of meat desired. Again, let's say chicken or beef or what have you. The cells are then placed on a biological scaffold to grow into the right shape and structure of the desired end product, like maybe a little steak patty. The bioreactor then turbocharges cell growth from a speck of cells to a full meal-sized serving of meat. Whoa. Okay, some reality checks. Bottom line, it's really not the science that's in question. It's consumers. Will meat-eating consumers, diehard meat people, go for this? And for what price premium? Because you can bet there'll be initially a price premium. Maybe over time as they ramp it up, not the case. And of course, the other thing one has to think about, especially out here in Oregon, our eastern Oregon is filled with ranchers and that sort of thing. So what's the financial impact, pardon me, on livestock ranchers and farmers and meat processing jobs and the butcher at your local store and all this sort of thing. So, you know, it's fascinating. It's interesting. My wife and I tend not to eat meat at all, but I do have sympathy for what it would mean to many people's jobs and lives if this took over and replaced traditional meat production. So,
yeah, it will probably, sorry, it will probably be a very slow kind of transition as we saw from, you know, I don't know many investors that are like, hey, give me money to start a new coal mine because, hey, coal mines are kind of on the way out. You know, renewable energy is on the uptick. Natural gas seems to be, you know, production seems to be ramping up. And of course, oil drilling will always be a thing, or at least for the foreseeable future. So, not all sources of energy are being, you know, like, it's not like, oh, we discovered solar, coal's out of here. I think this is going to be the same way. You know, it's not that, oh, we have another way to produce meat, cows are out of here. It will be a gradual change. I hope that the pain is very, you know, if there's any pain to be had, it's very spread out and very, you know, kind of manageable across years and years and years. Ralph, I got to say, though, that from my personal experience looking into this, because I do not avoid eating meat, I feel very guilty about it all the time, but I still eat it because it's, you know, it is what it is. But I got to say
flavor.
That, yeah, no, there's a lot of flavor. Although
and texture.
I do give a lot of credit to Impossible and Beyond Meat and these other companies because, you know, especially their sausages and, you know, their burger patties, they're very good. They really are. They're kind of health-wise, they're kind of equal. You know, there's a lot of saturated fat and they're very hyper-processed and all that good stuff. But I got to say that this, Ralph, last time this came up on the show, I'm very for it because you know, to everyone out there who's still having trouble thinking, why would I eat a, you know, meat grown in a laboratory? That sounds very weird. It's the same meat that would come off of a cow, a chicken, a whatever, or fish or what have you. It's just instead of spending the resources on the brain, the bones, the organs, the kind of everything else that makes an animal mm-hmm. that we, mm-hmm. you know, that we really discard in so many ways.
That's right.
You're just producing the one thing that we actually want, which is the food, you know, the parts that we eat for food. Ralph, one of the biggest challenges, as I understand it, that this meat has is that you can grow individual cells pretty easily, you know, and get them to reproduce. You give them plenty of the vitamins and nutrients that they need. They'll reproduce indefinitely. You're good to go, you know, kind of like yeast. The problem, though, is that, Ralph, you went through a lot of physical therapy, you know, for obviously past situations that you know. Muscle. And you know how muscle grows and, you know, and how you shape muscle. You tear the fibrous muscle and then you let it heal and you tear it and you heal. And, hey, you know, that's what working out is. Working out, you're tearing your muscle, letting it rebuild and bigger and stronger and better. Lab-grown meat, Ralph, does not do that. You know, it never supports a cow. It never pushes a fish up a river. It never goes through that process of being an actual muscle that is used. So the texture is insanely off. It's not like you can just print a ribeye steak. You know, the cells are the same as a ribeye steak, but it was never, but it never did that work, and it never developed that texture, and it never did that thing. So,
good point.
Yeah, so that's going to be the main hurdle, is that the, you know, it's going to taste the same, and the nutrients are going to be the same, but the textures are going to be wildly off, and that's what they need to work on, from my understanding.
No, that's good. That's good input. That's interesting.
Yeah, it's but I'm all for this, and it's definitely the way of the future, because again, instead of growing a cow, just be like, hey cow, you exist, and we're gonna kill you in a little bit. It's gonna be great for everyone but you. You know, this has to be the way of the future. Something that did
or
not
it's
have
one
feelings.
Of the ways of the future. To your point, it's gonna be one option that could be out there for people.
You know,
to choose.
one more thing, because you know, we've actually had guests on the show talking about this, Ralph, that I want you and our listeners to think about. When you can do this, it's not even that like you put in cows in one reactor, sheep in another reactor, chicken in another reactor, fish in another reactor. Imagine this. So there's two things. There's one gross one and one kind of weird one. One gross one is, Ralph, human. Hey, we're made of meat too. You could just as easily grow human meat, and you know, you shouldn't eat it for obvious reasons. Think mad cow disease, but in people. But it would be possible. I'm just saying, it's possible.
All I can think of is that old movie,
Soylent
old sci-fi
Green.
Movie. Green. It's people!
Soylent Green is people, absolutely. So there's that, but hey, it was never actually people. It's just made of people. But, okay, so that's the first weird one. The second weird one, Ralph, imagine if you could put in the cell cultures of... and I'm sure that, you know, a lot of people out there know that there's a lot of drawbacks to red meat. It's very bad for you. There's a lot of cholesterol. There's, you know, there's so many different things. That's why you have things like beefalo, which is buffalo mixed with beef cattle. It's supposed to be a little bit leaner, a little bit more nutritious, better for you, so on and so forth. Ralph, what if one day we decided that, you know, whose meat is really nutritious? Gazelle. And it actually pairs super nicely with, kangaroo meat, and you just take a sample of gazelle and kangaroo cell cultures, put them in a reactor together, and suddenly you get a proprietary gazelle-roo burger patty that you can then grill. You can get and these things are blended on like a cellular level. Like that is the meat now. It's part, let's say, part lion, part rhino, and it's not even like you have to like blend up a rhino to get the initial culture. Like it's not even that much. Like you just take a sample and you're good to go.
What a hoot.
So with that being said, Ralph, you can have incredible blends and different kinds of meat that you have never even thought of. And they could be more nutritious, leaner, better for you. You know, just there's so many possibilities to lab grown meat.
Yeah, wow. Well, that's a lot to think about and a lot to digest, no pun intended. Hey, with the time that's remaining, do you want to scan through the next series of stories and see if anything jumps out at you? Or we
story
can go on to story
six,
whatever you prefer.
Story number six, and I'll do just that. So, go for it.
Okay, story six. So, headline is SpaceX, good old SpaceX. SpaceX Starlink wins $885 million from the FCC to serve rural areas. Got this from Yahoo Finance. And here's the story. The FCC recently revealed the results of the first phase of its Rural Digital Opportunity Fund auction. And one of the biggest winners is Elon Musk's SpaceX. SpaceX Starlink satellite internet service won the $885.5 million in federal subsidies, if I could say it, provide high-speed broadband internet to more than 5.2 million unserved, 5.2 million unserved homes and businesses in rural America. Isn't that astonishing to think in 2021, we have that many people in this country who can't even get internet service?
Real quick, Ralph. I'm going to ask you this. How many people... In 2020, had DSL. DSL or dial-up? Let's say DSL or dial-up. Take
in
a
what
guess.
Year? 2021? 2020?
2020. Yeah, 2020.
Are people still doing dial-up?
Yep.
Holy moly. Okay, I don't know. 20 million?
Let's see. According to the numbers here, and Ralph, I'm going to let you go ahead and continue on while I find the exact number. But I know that AT&T still gets millions of dollars from people on dial-up. Go ahead.
Oh, my Lord. I can't even I never even thought about it in years. Anyway, going on with the story while you're checking that out. SpaceX is expected to cover 35 locations in the United States with the subsidies it'll receive over the next 10 years. To secure the funding, SpaceX will have to prove that it can provide broadband services to those areas for a price that's in line with terrestrial broadband offerings. At the moment, Starlink beta testers have to pay $99 a month. That seems steep. Not including, get this, $499 of upfront cost needed for the satellite dish and hardware kit. Obviously, those expenses for these underserved rural areas are going to have to be subsidized in some way to make this even sensible. But it's an interesting thing. It's a classic example of one of these stories that kind of flies under the radar in the mainstream press, and it's sort of fun to bring it up and think about how many people in our country are still disabled, if you were, in terms of having internet access, which I think everyone would agree is critical. And then your dial-up thing is fascinating. I had no idea.
Yep. And by the way, I was actually looking at that. By the way, the speed of dial-up has gotten to an incredible almost 1 megabyte a second. Like, that is about the highest extent that we can get dial-up to currently. And about 0.6% of all households in the United States in November 2020 had dial-up. And I'm sorry, November 2019, there we go. 0.6 had dial-up. Okay. And in places like Georgia, 2% of all households still use dial-up.
Wow.
Yeah. Who knew? It's a problem. And I've actually talked with people, Ralph. I've had people come in the show and tell me this, that all they have access to is like DSL or dial-up. And, the alternative is that last, like, let's say if you're like 4 miles down the road, you have to pay out of your own pocket to get them to run a fiber line down to your house. Because if you're the only customer, they're not going to spend the money. So, yeah, this seems like the best solution. Ralph, looking at the other stories, man, oh man, we talked a little bit about Apple Car. I say that we don't do the, kind of the entire thing, but I did want your reaction to a continuing rumor mill that Apple is going to produce a car. That's hopefully, something that we can just talk about real quick with story number 7, and then we'll move on from there.
Sure. So again, in a nutshell, folks, come back and get the show notes. Basically, this comes from Apple Insider, a story by Mike Peterson, and it says Apple brings in TSMC, the Taiwan semiconductor maker, to develop chips for a Tesla-like self-driving Apple car. So on the basic surface of this, the article itself is actually reporting on a Taiwan-based outfit called DigiTimes and their reports about Apple working maybe on a autonomous driving vehicle chip technology and pairing up with TSMC to produce it and so forth and so on. But then it goes on to further speculate maybe in the works is the idea of an Apple-branded full-up electric car. So TBD, I will say this, can you just imagine how beautiful the design would be inside and out if the Apple folks did make a car? So there's just something to think about.
Yeah, it's really something that we've talked about for a long time with Apple and car and their car ambition. And, they famously hired people and fired people before actually bringing a product to market. And I got to say that as of the last time that I covered this topic, Ralph, they have more people on staff than ever before who have a car background. So they are more committed to bringing out a car than anyone else. And if I'm not mistaken, you might have had it here, although I don't see it. The last reporting that we did was like a week ago, and saying that they're going to rely on Hyundai to actually use their plants and their manufacturing capabilities to make Apple's cars, because Apple doesn't want to set up the whole supply chain and factories to make cars.
Of course not.
But they might partner with Hyundai. The talks are very, very new, but yeah, they might contract them to actually manufacture it.
Well, it's fun to speculate.
I know that Craig would get one. If they put one out, Craig would definitely. Craig is a huge Apple fan person.
Oh my gosh, yes. And I know many people who would. I totally get it. It would be, I would just love to see it. I think it'd be a hoot and a half.
Yeah, definitely. So with that being said, Ralph, I think one of the last stories, if we have time, we're going to go ahead and jump down to story number 8, because I love these consumer products. And like I said, these things don't affect you. These things don't affect our listeners day to day. But hey, down the road, this is going to be your new TV.
Yes. Headline: Samsung just unveiled a $156,000 bezel-less, 110-inch micro LED TV that you can't buy from BGR.com. And real quick here, Samsung recently announced a stunning 110-inch micro LED TV. And in fact, I think they're showcasing that at the Digital CES, as I recall, that is available for pre-order in Korea today, with global distribution to start in the first quarter of 2021. The 110-inch TV will cost 170 million won in Korea, around $156,000 US. The bezel-less TV features much better image quality than traditional LED displays. It's a modular TV system that can be customized for any wall in your living room, and it's all based on micro LED display technology. The screen is made up of very small LEDs that turn on and off independently. That eliminates the need for a backlight and allows Samsung to offer an even better picture quality than traditional LED TVs without going for the more expensive OLED, that's organic light emitting diode solution that we're so familiar with. The micro AI processor supports 4K HDR content and lets you split the screen into four 55-inch TVs, virtual screens, that can use independent inputs to stream four different programs. Great for the sports nut who wants to have, you know, multiple football games going on at the same time or something like that, right? Pretty cool. Or to have maybe a video conference going on while you're watching a show together, or the, you know, your imagined takeover. But the size of this thing is huge, 110 inches. Holy smokers. That's as big as my projection system next door to me here from my home office in my bonus room, where I'm using a big Panasonic projector to get that on a screen about 110 inches. So I know how big that image is.
Yeah. And by the way, the video that we're showing here, this is actually something that, because we are part of CES and I knew just where to find it, this is actually their presentation that that I was able to
get.
The monolith design, this is exactly, I think, this is the exact product image that they use for the article there. And yeah, this is kind of what they showed off. And it was really stunning. It was really cool to see that it wasn't the same technology as the wall that they've been showing off, which was, again, like the 156-inch that it used to be. Don't get me wrong, Ralph. $156,000, not affordable, I would say.
No, not at all.
Not affordable, but... from what I recall about, you know, kind of reading some of the press material, let's see, and they said that it was a modular TV system that can be customized for any wall in your room. Essentially, you tell them kind of what size you want, up to 110 inches, and it comes in these little packs, and they have a special kind of like suction cups that you suction onto the front of them, and... You and like the back comes in one piece, and then you just kind of like suction cup the panels onto it, and they all kind of interlock, and you can make it any kind of custom size you want. Think of like honestly, if anyone here has experience with Jumbotrons, exact same process as setting up a Jumbotron, because I know that everyone has set up a Jumbotron in their lives.
Of course.
With that being said, it's an amazing looking TV, and this new emphasis on micro LED. I think it was not Samsung, but it was actually LG. I don't know, Ralph, if you saw their TV technology. What they did was they also used kind of micro LEDs, although, it was definitely LG, where they had multiple LEDs because they were able to shrink them down even further. Like, they showed this diagram that, of course, is blown up for people, but it was like the LEDs, and then they had a diffuser that kind of blurred the LED so you don't see little pinpoints of light, and it was able to kind of blend the colors a little bit. And then they had the screen, you know, that everyone kind of watches, and they had it kind of blown up, but it looked like massive distance. It was the number of microns. Because they were able to squeeze in even more LEDs, they made the distance between the LEDs and the diffuser like Nothing, like literally zero nanometers. And so the TVs, like if you thought TVs couldn't get any thinner, there's the music. If you thought TVs couldn't get any thinner, Ralph, yeah,
they're,
yeah, LG was able to make them a couple micrometers,
millimeters,
even smaller than that. They were make it even thinner than that.
Wow.
CES was actually a lot of fun. There was a lot of great news coming out of that, and it was really fun to see. So I'm glad that you were able to include some stories from that, and yeah, a lot of stories that we did not get to. So everyone, computeramerica.com, and of course, Ralph has his own website, Ralph Bond Wicks, if you just want to go ahead and search that up, or head on over to Computer America, and we'll have his link right there at the top of the show notes. Ralph, until next time, thank you so much.
Hey, always a joy.
All right. And of course, everyone, Ralph waves by, I wave by, and everyone, thank you so much for tuning in. Check out the podcast if you missed today's show. And if you listen to us live on IRN, we thank you so much. Everyone, have a great day. Bye, everyone. Have a good weekend.